Welcome everyone to True Big
yours and you are mine. Yeah. Fog has Thank you. so whole. You made us worthy, yes. Stand right here in your presence. You are worthy, worthy. You are worthy, worthy, worthy of all of our praises.
Oh, morning.
The Lord says, I want you to let go of everything.
There's no guilt. There's no shame. There's no lying. Saying you have caused this, you deserve it, this is your fault. The Lord says, I want to take everything away from you today that the enemy has put on you. He says, you just let it go. That's your only mission today, is let it go. And I will take it, says the Lord.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The Lord says, because you have humbled yourself.
Thank you, God.
And set your opinion and your desires aside, the Lord says, everything I have for you is going to start coming in to your life. And it'll be beyond anything you ever imagined.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord. He doesn't forget.
And so it begins.
Thank you, Jesus.
I need a Kleenex. I'm snotting up here like a baby. And who says God doesn't have a sense of humor?
Thank you, Lord. Praise God. He doesn't forget. He remembers. Thank you, Jesus.
One of the prophetic words that I refer to, the prophet mentioned something about the Spirit will move and the tears will flow.
That's right.
And I said, can we talk about that?
No, it's not negotiable.
Can it be like something else?
Not negotiable.
So for some of you who maybe have not experienced a move of God,
yeah,
especially in the area of demonic coming out,
right?
Several ways that happens is tears. Tears is always a demonic entity leaving.
Amen.
Yawning. All of a sudden you're yawning like a big dog. Mm. If you're coughing and you feel like something's coming up out of your tummy,
yes,
that is a demonic entity that is now leaving your physical body. Okay? It's not weird. It's not abnormal. It is the way God has set up the spiritual realm, that we stand in the physical, but we operate out of the spiritual. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Oh. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Yes. Yes.
Now, I'm as shocked as you, because I just come up here and was going to give a word, and all of a sudden I can't talk. Excuse me, I'm going to blow snot out of my nose.
Oh, right on the mic. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh,
thank you, Lord.
Today we are going to.
Hallelujah.
Am I switched over or back there on the overhead?
Not giving the option, the cable.
Do what? You say I broke it? That's power.
It's not switching.
The only other place it is over along the wall. There's a connection.
Did it come undone?
Ooh, break it?
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
There you go.
Praise God. Praise
God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Guys, ready?
Yeah.
I hope so.
You got your, you got your baseball gloves on?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ready.
There's so much that I want to share with you. Some of it is so crazy deep. But today, the Lord says, is not the day. So we're going to do some very basic. How do I fight the enemy? I thought Jesus already defeated him.
Mm.
He did. But you got to understand how God works.
Right.
Did Jesus die for everybody?
Yep. Yes.
Did he make salvation available to everybody?
Yes.
Is everybody saved?
No.
Oh. So things were made available to us, but we need to partake, we need to grab a hold of, we need to use, right? So I might have that golden American Express card, but I don't have the pin, and so it's just a piece of plastic in my wallet. So are some of the things of God. If we don't know how to activate it, or we're walking in blindness, confusion, pride. Pride is so gigantic. Religious nonsense, we'll never grab a hold of it.
Right.
The Lord says, come to me as a
child.
A child doesn't walk in the room and say, yo, Dad. You know, now that I'm 5, I think I've got a handle on everything, so I want you to break out the cookies, right? We go to mom and dad, we go, hey, cookie, 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 and they go, okay. So we need to come to them very childlike, yeah, with no preconception of what we think, mm-hmm, or what we know.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of times what we think we know, we don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've spent 20 years unlearning everything I knew because I found out it was all leaning to the left or to the right.
Right.
So how do we fight the enemy? First off, the enemy is not a giant dragon 25 stories tall.
Mm.
It's not Godzilla. He is not all powerful.
No.
He cannot kill everybody on the planet because it have already happened.
Right.
So the enemy is a greatly defeated enemy.
Hallelujah.
But he still has power.
Mm.
And his main power is lying and confusion.
Mm.
And he has a whole horde of little monkeys working for him that we call demons. Okay? So how do we fight the enemy? We're going to go to Ephesians, and of course, right now, you're going to say, well, I've read this 82 times. Well, that's good. Maybe 82 times you missed something. I read scripture every day, and I go, oh, I didn't see that.
Amen.
I'm always, you know, this is, you want to know how me and Pastor Heather operate? I get up in the morning, and I drive to a local restaurant with my laptop, and I sit, and I eat breakfast, and I study. When I'm done, I get in my truck, and I call Pastor Heather, and I jabber like a little kid all the things that I just read.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I love
that
it.
That is our ritual in the morning. And then, you know, I go to the office, and a couple hours later, I got to see what Heather's doing. Uh-huh. And call her back up, and she goes, well, I was just listening to this and this and this. And then I hear a whole bunch of stuff coming from her back at me.
Hallelujah. In the spirit.
Because of our calling, we're in a constant state of reading, studying,
always,
receiving, and throwing out.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Throwing out. Mm. Throwing out. How many of you were here on Friday night warring women?
Woo!
Hallelujah!
Woo! The first time I taught on the foot washing, the church that I grew up in, every 3 or 4 months they'd have a foot washing service, and they would choose 3 or 4 people, and the pastor, whatever, would come up and wash their feet. And this is how they taught it. Well, it's teaching you to be a servant, to wash somebody else's foot. Now when I read the story, I go, that was the stupidest thing they ever said.
Just ignorant.
It had nothing at all to do with me humbling myself and washing your dirty toes. And so if we're not constantly getting new revelation, so the revelation was Jesus came in, took off all his robes of a rabbi, put on the robes of a servant,
yes,
took water and started washing their feet. He comes to Peter, the amazing Peter, who was, can I say knucklehead?
Yeah.
Okay. Peter put his foot in his mouth so many times. Jesus comes to wash Peter's feet, and Peter says, no, you shall not wash my feet. Now think about that. Peter is telling God, no, you're not going to do that. And Jesus said, if you don't let me do this, you'll have no part of me. And then Peter goes, well, wash all of me. And Jesus says, what I've made clean is clean. Now that word is in the Levitical, cleansing spiritually, cleansing religiously, cleansing under the law. And then he says, all I need to do now is to wash you with the word. And that word washing there is washing your clothes. So the whole thing about the feet washing was, I've made you perfect.
Amen.
When you put faith in me. Now as you go through life on this planet, how do I get the dirt of this world off of me? I wash myself with the word of God.
Amen.
It has nothing to do with us washing each other's feet. It's something that God has done to us and then made available to us. So I always want to look at Scripture, look at whatever it is that God is teaching with an open mind as much as humanly possible.
Thank you, Jesus.
So in Ephesians, Paul says, finally, and this is the complete Jewish Bible translation. It's a little different, but I like the wording in some of the parts. And trust me, I go back and look at every main word in the original to make sure that they haven't slipped any monkey riches in there. Finally, grow powerful in union with the Lord, in union with his mighty strength. So what is the first part of me putting on the armor of God and fighting the enemy?
Union.
I got to be in union.
Right.
I got to be in unity. So then the question begs, is there anybody here who's not saved? Is there any, because I don't do this every week, because the Lord doesn't lead me to it. If you don't know you're saved, it takes about 10 seconds and we can take care of that.
Amen.
Well, what do I got to do? Well, you have to come up to the front, cry really hard, and feel very sorrowful.
No.
Oh, that's not biblical? Oh, okay. You got to come to the altar, and all the elders got to come up and slap oil on it.
No.
Oh. So then how do we get saved?
Believe. Jesus.
We have the perfect example with the thief. The thief said, I'm guilty.
Yes.
I deserve this.
Amen.
He's innocent. He doesn't deserve it.
Amen.
Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. So now we zip over to the end of Matthew and it says, those who believe in me shall be saved. So my salvation is, I need a Savior. I have to acknowledge that I am not righteous in myself.
Yeah.
The only one who can be my Savior is Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, I surrender my self-righteousness, and I put faith in what you did at the cross, and I declare you're Lord.
Amen.
Boom, you just got born again.
Amen.
All kinds of things happened unseen spiritually. Number one, you died. The old Adam guy just died.
That's right. Awesome. Hallelujah.
You got plugged in the ground, and then you rose as a new creation in Christ. So now you're part of Jesus. You're part of the body of Christ. You're a new creation. All the old things, that old Adam thing, the old sin of the old one separated from God is gone. You're now a new creation. So now as a new creation, I got to meditate on that. And it says, it grow. I can grow.
Yes.
How well did I know Heather on the day we got married? Paquito. I knew I liked certain aspects. Okay? I liked her heart. I liked that she sang. Oh my gosh, the day after the wedding, my whole life just got all crazy. Because there was somebody else in the house who had their own opinion. What do you mean I can't lay around and watch John Wayne movies all day long? But over the years, I've grown to know her.
Hallelujah.
I know her likes. I know her personality. I know how her mind thinks.
Amen.
So when you got saved, you knew little bit about Jesus.
Right.
Now I'm going to grow in the revelation of who I am, who
Amen.
He's made me to be,
Amen.
How I can operate as a child of God. And the problem is we went to a church where they piled on a whole lot of kakadoodoo, and you spent all your time trying to be worthy.
It's religion.
Right.
And that got fixed and all done the minute you said, Jesus is Lord. Can you get more righteous than you are today?
No.
It's a gift. Just receive it all.
It's a gift.
That's right.
You're covered in His righteousness.
Yes.
So as I learn to walk out who I am in Christ, I'm covered.
Yes.
Just let it go. You're all right. It'll keep perfect.
I know it keeps on coming.
It's gonna. It's like it just you're good. Just let it go.
Hallelujah.
So I'm growing in the revelation of who I am in Christ.
That's right.
And it's not me doing a bunch of stuff to be worthy. It's because I'm worthy, I want to be led all the time
Amen.
By the Spirit
That's
of
the
God.
Union.
So I can grow more powerful in union with the Lord, in union with His mighty power.
Woo!
So now I have to have a revelation that I have access to the power of God
Wow.
because I'm born again.
That's right.
The church of my youth, Lord, help us.
Right.
Lord, don't pass us by.
Okay.
We all sing that song.
Right.
Lord, don't pass me by. Everybody be quiet. You're going to offend the Holy Spirit because He's really sensitive. He's going to run out the door.
No.
Do you realize how
ignorant
so many of the songs we sang and our attitude? Well, we don't believe in praying in tongues. That all died with the apostles. Wow, then God's a psychopath. God comes to earth, sends Jesus, and He heals everybody. But as soon as Jesus, the last apostle, dies, now we're just kind of sucking it up and we're on our own.
No, never.
Amen.
I'm just suffering for Jesus.
You have to think about these things.
So I got to get all these old things out of my head. So,
Amen.
Number one, I'm in union with the Lord and I can grow. And I'm in union with His mighty power. So
wow.
I have to have that
yeah,
as my foundation.
So good.
Verse 11. Use all the armor and weaponry that God provides.
Yeah, man. Use it.
So that means I can grab some of the weaponry and some of the armor and not all of it.
Use it.
So I know, but here what I'm saying is I can be operating in some of the armor. And I'm wondering why I'm not really victorious.
Uh-huh.
Why the enemy keeps beating me up.
Right.
I need to get all of it.
Amen.
It's like I'm going to play football with a helmet. But nothing else.
You'll get hurt bad.
And every play is over, I'm going, coach, my arms are broken. Right. I got broken rib. No.
Right.
I got to put all the uniform on, all the pads
on. Come on, that's a great analogy. Great analogy.
And so when we put it all on so that we will be able to stand against the deceptive tactics of the enemy.
That's good. That's
so the enemy doesn't come in bluntly and do things. It's always a little sly.
Sneaky.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Are you really righteous? Yeah.
Mm.
Did he really promise you that?
Mm.
Come on.
Ooh.
Right.
What about what you feel?
Faith.
Is God going to bless you with what you did?
Mm-hmm.
See, he's going to attack you in some sly, deceptive way to make you doubt who you are in Christ.
He's the accuser. Uh-huh.
Amen?
Amen.
Now, if I don't have a union with Jesus, I'm like the men in Judges 21.
Mm.
At that time, there was no king in Israel. Who's the king?
Jesus.
So if I don't have a relationship with King Jesus,
right,
I'm out there on my own, and it says, a man simply did whatever he thought was right.
Oh, there's a church.
Do you know how many churches are operating this morning going, well, we think, we had a committee and we voted on it.
Lord.
No problem.
I got in a godly debate with my Bible college teacher who had a doctorate, and he was talking about the different types of churches, and he was talking about a congregational church. And I said, that's unbiblical. I thought I was going to choke right in the air. He goes, no, God has given us wisdom. We can rule ourselves.
Oh.
Whoa.
Oh, devil.
Whoa.
That's a devil.
Govern ourselves. Yeah, that was not good.
So in a congregational type church, they put an advertisement out for a pastor. And then five or six pastors come, and they come in, they preach on a Sunday. And then the church votes, and the board votes, and they decide, I think number two, I want him to be my shepherd.
No.
So now they've turned the pastor into a hireling.
There you go. Right. Higher and fire.
How many of you people voted on me in heaven? You didn't. And guess what? You never will.
Amen. Amen.
Because God told me to start the church and her to start the church. And I ain't asking anybody what to do with the church.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, but if God's got to talk to you about what I need to do, then I need to retire.
Oh, mercy.
That's right.
Yes, oh,
well, that's kind of arrogant. No, that's how God works.
Yeah,
I've had people leave the church and say, well, it was like it was always the Larry and Heather show. Well, whose show should it have been?
Jesus.
It's a Jesus show. But see, you wanted to be part of the hierarchy, and God didn't call you.
It doesn't work that way.
I have people coming in the door all the time. The Lord's told me I'm supposed to be your shield bearer and stand next to you. I didn't get that message. I'm sorry. And then they're here for two or three weeks. They find out they can't run the place. They leave. They leave.
Help us, Jesus.
I'm going to be here for the long haul. And they're gone.
Yeah.
So there's some things in the kingdom that we have to understand.
Can't do what's just right.
So let's go back to Ephesians. In chapter, verse 12. For we are not struggling against human beings.
That's right.
Yeah.
If I could just get rid of that person in the seventh row... No, I'm not fighting against that person.
Right. No.
Gigi's immediately counting how many rows. One, two, three, four, five, six. See, there's not seven. I knew it.
Thank you,
Gigi. See, I made sure that I was counting. There's no rows. So I'm not struggling against a person.
No, right.
I'm fighting against the entities that are attached or behind the person.
Come on, there it is.
Wow. Yep.
That's right, Apostle.
Powerful. I go to the restaurant in the morning, and on Sunday, there's a man who has some challenges, who sits across the restaurant. Larry, hi. Hi, Larry. I just wanted to say good morning. Hi. How you doing? Or he walks across the restaurant. I just thought I'd say hi.
Oh, amen.
Hi. You leave early, don't you? And it's like, my flesh wants to choke this individual, but it's not the individual, it's the enemy behind it that is trying to control me, through this other poor soul who needs to get delivered.
Amen.
So we have to walk in love. We have to walk in compassion.
Yes.
Did Jesus shake his head sometimes at the end of the day and go, are you sure I was supposed to call Peter?
Probably.
That's if you want him. Okay. You're not going to go to the cross, Lord. You got it. I did it. I know. We're not fighting against people. But we're fighting against rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers governing this darkness against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. Now, we all go to those three different words and we go, what does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean? And we try to break it down to different entities. And the problem is the church has not taught you who the entities are, and then the translations, when they went from the original Hebrew or Aramaic into Greek, they lose nuance.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
So the word leader is first in order. So who is the number one evil entity that we fight on this earth?
Satan,
fallen angel, right? So who else are leaders? Do you know there are territorial leaders in the dark side?
Yes.
What if I told you that God put them in place?
Yep.
I'm going to touch really quick on something, and we don't want to get sidetracked.
Okay.
At the Tower of Babel, man had rebelled again, and again, and again. And when God came, he said, I'm going to break them up because right now they're in one accord and they're going to be able to accomplish what they want to do. So he started changing their languages and scattering them all over the earth.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you read in there, it talks about he talked to the sons of God, which is referencing a spiritual entity.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, and I will put them under these entities. Who were they already worshiping?
Satan.
Nephilim, fallen angels. So God placed over each one of these people groups in different areas the demonic entities that they wanted to worship.
Wow.
So when we look at certain countries and go, well, why are they? They're just so wicked. You know, if you go back and study the Aztecs or some of those people, and you go like, and you go into Indonesia and some places, some of their religions were horrid. That's because God put a demonic entity over them. Then he came around and he started a whole new race of people for him in Abraham.
Amen.
Ooh.
Wow. Okay.
And what did he say about the children of Abraham?
They
are going to be kings and priests.
Yeah.
Who are they going to be kings and priests to? All those people under the demonic influence. So now, most of the Jews rejected Christ. So then it became the time of the Gentiles.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So our job is to go and spread the gospel. So when I go into an area, there are entities that are ruling nations.
Principalities. Prince of Persia.
They are demonic. I believe they're fallen angels.
Yes.
I'm not going to fight that unless God tells me to.
Amen.
Yes.
Right. Now, we go down lower and there's
ranks,
and you start getting into Nephilim that are over regions,
right,
over cities.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what is that? How do you get with? Who says that? Don't you know that you will judge angels?
Yeah.
Yes.
Who said that?
Jesus.
Paul. Didn't Paul say it?
It's quoted from Psalm.
It's quoted from Psalms. And then when you do the story of the talents, mm-hmm, the good and faithful servant, us, the Gentiles, mm-hmm, will be in charge of cities.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, come on.
Mm-hmm. We're going to replace those demonic entities ruling the people in the age to come.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Okay?
Thank
so,
you, Lord.
So that's the leaders. Now the next one, it says authorities. That's someone who's given power. So that could be the lower level demonic entities. And then the last word, they just do a very generic devils and demons. So that's any demonic unclean spirit. And that's what we deal with, is the low level demons. For the most part, we are not messing with higher level things. We're dealing with personal things in our life, okay? So when we go out and start praying in a realm that we're not called to do,
right, you have no power.
You have no power, and if that entity started to focus on you, you would be in bad shape.
Right.
Because you would not have the weaponry to fight back.
That's right.
So, verse 13, so take up every piece of the war equipment of God. This is the second time now he's saying pick up all of it.
Amen. Everything.
The equipment God provides so that when the evil day comes, you will be able to resist. And when the battle is won, you shall still be standing.
Glory, yeah.
Can you turn the heat off? All these warm bodies in here, it's 87 degrees in my mind. So there's going to be a time that the enemy is going to attack us, the evil day. And what are we to do? We are to
resist with the armor.
So when the enemy comes in and says, this is your life, you made it, you suck, and this is what it's going to be, it's never going to change. I got to resist that lie.
Right. Amen.
I got to say, no, it's going to get better.
Yeah.
Well, I got a report. I guess this is what my lot in life is. No. We don't ignore the report, but we resist it.
That's right.
No, I'm not receiving that report.
That's right.
That's not who I am. That's not what I am going to receive.
Amen.
Okay? So when the battle's won, I need to still be standing. If I win the battle and I'm all broken, laying on the ground, I did not win.
Mm.
14. Therefore, stand. The first thing he says is put on the belt of truth.
Yeah.
Now, they say belt, also the word can mean girdle.
Mm-hmm.
Or gird up your loins.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, come on.
So, my undergarment, if I can say it politely, mm-hmm, that girds me up and protects my reproductive organs, male or female,
okay,
because that's where life comes from, right? So there's used a lot of metaphors. It's got to be Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
He is the truth.
So my closest armor, most personal thing is Jesus.
Amen.
Who he is, who he's made me to be in the relationship we have.
Amen.
Number one, I got to put on Christ.
Amen.
Then I need to put on the breastplate of righteousness. I'm going to cover my heart and my soul.
Yes.
Amen.
My heart is my belief.
Mm-hmm.
My soul is my identity, my emotions, how I think, and my personality.
Yes.
Amen.
So I got to cover that with, you're perfect, you're righteous, you are. The actual word righteous means as you ought to be,
right,
according to God.
Yes.
Amen.
Okay? So when you're born again, you're made the way God wants you to be. Now, where we get all jacked up and confused is I still have the old mind and I still have the old fleshly body. Okay? So we need to put on Jesus. We need to put on righteousness. And then wear on your feet the readiness that comes from the good news of peace.
Yes.
What is the gospel about?
God, peace with
the gospel is I am no longer at war with God.
Amen.
We're at peace.
Amen.
There's no distance between me and God anymore. We've been reconciled back together. So wherever I go, whatever situation I walk into, I should always know I'm not alone.
Amen.
The God of the universe is with me.
Hallelujah.
Now, if I keep walking into places I ain't supposed to be,
get out.
I'm going to get some mud on me.
Okay. Yeah.
Some stuff's going to happen that I'm not going to like.
Right.
Get that phone. Verse 16, always carry the shield of trust.
Yes.
Who do I trust?
Jesus.
Now, I trust my prayer time.
No.
I trust all my good works.
No.
I trust my education. I trust my bank account. I trust my mommy and daddy. You know, we get all these different things that we put our trust in, but it has to be going back to my relationship with God.
Yes.
And I carry that shield with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one.
Ooh, right.
Yes.
Now, why a flaming arrow? That's a double whammy.
Right.
Enemy shoots a dart at you.
Mm-hmm.
You have some sickness. Oh. And then if I leave it, and it's on fire, it now spreads through every place of my body.
It does.
I need to pull that arrow out, or I need to stop it with the shield and say no.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I ministered in Pakistan last night, and one of the things I noticed is I have a hard time getting them to talk. So they come up for prayer, and I said, I want you to renounce. So Pastor Kashif translates to them, they do this. And every Sunday I go, Kashif, they have to say it.
Yes. Speak. Yeah. Uh-huh. Wow. Yeah. Culture. Demonic.
I have built a very what's the word I want to say? Informal relationship with the church. I don't come in stuffy, I don't come in kiss my ring. I come in very, I'm here to help you. I'm here to minister to you. So they're all sitting there smiling at me, and I'm saying, anybody have any questions? I'll answer any questions you guys have. Not a peep. Not a word. Remember in church, you want to ask your pastor, what the heck are you talking about?
Yeah. You weren't allowed.
Yeah.
You weren't allowed. Shut up. I went to Bible college, and they told me, don't ask questions. I said, I'm paying for this, and I can't ask questions? You guys are nuts. So the enemy wants to shut your mouth.
Right. Yeah.
Come on.
Or you just babble dumb stuff immediately every time it just comes out of you. I have the ability to say stupid in any situation. Pastor Dane was teaching on Satan was the god of this world. And I said, no, he's not. God is the God of this world. He had to call his secretary over and say, show Larry the scripture. Showed me the scripture, and I felt like whale poo-poo. That means I was really low in the ocean.
Yeah, yeah.
So as I grew and I started teaching at the church, I got up and I said, it'd be really cool if I write like what the original language looked like. So when I was translating the word and I wrote it up there and I says, now this is what the Hebrew looks like. And someone in the audience says, we're in the New Testament, it's Greek. So I popped off a lot of times thinking I knew something and I didn't know it. And so I have tried really hard over the last 20 years Because this is my wife. I'll say something. Google. Or does that airplane really fly at 3,000 miles an hour? I mean, I'll throw stuff out there, and she's over there Googling. And she's calling me on the carpet because I had a tendency when we first got married to just vomit information out because I felt so insecure. So now I'm pretty closed-mouthed unless I know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
So what I got angry at her about was really her God using her to train me.
Thank you.
You need to put some reins on that tongue. Amen.
Amen.
Why are you laughing so hard?
It's Jesus.
We love you.
They're laughing at me, man. So when I have the shield of faith, I can stop that lie that comes flying at me from the evil one.
Amen.
Paul then in verse 17 says, take up the helmet of deliverance or salvation along with the sword given by the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So what do I cover my head with? My brain. I'm saved. I'm delivered. I'm redeemed. So when the enemy comes in with a lie, I was talking to some ladies last Sunday, and at the back door, and I says, you know, what the problem is, a lot of you guys are so guilty. There's a lot of guilt on you. You're still under, there's some legalism in you. Okay? I got to understand, I'm delivered.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
There is no more guilt
Amen.
On me.
Amen. Lord, Apostle.
Freedom.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, until the law came, any of your missing the marks were never credited to you.
What Paul wrote. It's not credited
okay?
to you. That's right.
So, Jesus didn't abolish the law. He fulfilled it.
Amen.
So, the Apostle Paul comes along and says, you died to the law. Mm-hmm. If I am dead to the law, can any of my missing the marks be credited back to me?
No. As long as I put my faith in Christ.
It says all those things written against you are nailed to the
cross. Hallelujah.
So I'm not law-minded. I am spirit-minded.
Yes.
I am righteous-minded.
Yes.
I get up this morning and I'm driving down to church. I came early. I turned the lights on when you got here. Turned the heater on. And I'm immediately going, Lord, let it all be your voice and not mine.
Amen.
Speak through me.
Yes.
Let it be your words. So I'm immediately humbling myself and saying, I'm not going to come in with my agenda.
Right.
Amen.
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 So we put on the helmet of deliverance. And then the last thing we do is take up the Word of God and fight the enemy.
Come on.
Yeah.
But so many Christians I see grab the Word of God, don't put on any of the other stuff, and are running around slashing, dashing, and stabbing the air, having no clue who they are.
Right.
I don't understand why I keep getting beat up by the enemy. Well, you're still trying to earn your salvation.
Ooh.
By trying to earn your salvation, you automatically disqualify yourself.
Mm.
Really? Yeah, Paul says if you go up to God with your self-righteousness, it is now a debt.
Right.
When you go to God and says, look at how good I am. Boop, it's an hour of death.
Yeah.
I never want to go to God and say, see, I'm doing everything you told me to.
Ooh.
Never, ever, ever, ever. No. Okay. So that's the armor that we need to put on. Could you turn the fan on? Now, I couldn't find a picture of Hebrew Jesus, so I got white European Jesus here. Jesus was taken out to be tempted. So I want to see how the enemy tempted Jesus and how Jesus responded to the temptations of the enemy. We're good? We're tracking?
Yes.
So in Matthew 4, we're going to go through verses 1 through 11. Then the Spirit led Jesus up into the wilderness to be tempted by the adversary. After Jesus had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry, and then the adversary came. Jesus had no power left in his physical body. So he's not going to withstand the enemy physically. He's going to resist the enemy spiritually and with the Word of God. Okay? What's the first thing the enemy said to Jesus? If you are the Son of God, order these stones to become bread. In other words, cater to your flesh. That's what that temptation is all about. Jesus said, man does not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. How many of you live your life totally under the control of your flesh? That is something you need to examine and say, am I just being led by my flesh all the time? I need to crucify my flesh and be led by the Spirit. Okay? And when Heather first met me, I was a flesh boy. You know, if I saw it, I wanted it. If I want, you know, I bought it, I ate it, I want, you know, whatever. My flesh was totally in control. And so I have learned, with the help of the Spirit of God, to tell the flesh to take a hike. Second temptation, verse 5, then the adversary took him to the holy city and set him up on the highest part of the temple. Wait a second. The devil took Jesus and transported him to the temple and put him up on top. This is before the cross. Satan had a lot of power.
Yeah.
He could do some wacky-do stuff.
Right.
Okay? He then says to Jesus, what? If you are, he attacked him again with his identity. If you are the Son of God, jump. Because the Word says he will order his angels to be responsible for you. They will support you with their hands so that you will not hurt your foot on the stones. Jesus replied, but also says, do not put God to the test.
Amen.
Everything is legal to me, Paul said, but not everything is beneficial.
Right.
Well, you know, I'm under grace so I can do that.
No.
I'm under grace so I can watch that.
No.
I'm under grace so I can go to that place. I'm tempting God.
Right, right. Come on. Do it.
I'm tempting God. I'm believing God is going to bless me and protect me, going into places I have no business being, doing things I should have no business doing.
Exactly. Wow.
You know, there are certain things. I would love to have a motorcycle. I had a motorcycle when I was a young man. I had several of them. I rode a lot. And the Lord goes, no.
Amen.
That's too big of a target.
Yeah.
I love horses. I love to go horseback riding. At my age and my weight, if I fell off a horse, I could probably break 30 or 40 bones. Don't want to do it. Heather said, you know, I'd really like to go parachute out of a plane. I just thought for a second, yeah. And then I heard, no. So there are certain things at my point in life that I am not going to do. I'm not going to go down to the bar and get hammered and then drive to L.A.
Okay.
Well, I got God with me. No, I'm not going to tempt God. And so we need to ask ourselves, are there things that I'm letting into my life that I have no business being a part of?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So I'm not going to tempt God.
Amen.
Third temptation. Once more, the adversary took him up on a mountain of a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their glory, and he said to him, Jesus, all this I will give you if you will bow down and worship me. Away with you, Satan.
Come on.
Jesus said, for the word of God says, worship God and serve him only. Then the adversary left. The last one is the one that we can see very in your face. In the entertainment business,
yes.
I have heard way back when I was a kid, like at RC Records, that there was an altar at the bottom of that brown building. And musicians would come in and give their soul or sell their soul or make a promise to the devil so they could have a career.
Wow.
How many of you heard the song Stairway to Heaven?
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Who wrote it?
Led Zeppelin.
Do you know when he wrote it? He was high, sitting in a room, watching a fireplace, and a demon came out of the fireplace and gave him the words.
Yeah.
He said he wrote that song in about 3 minutes.
Oh, wow.
How many pictures have you seen with...
They hold that...
Movie stars.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
They're all doing demonic signs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The person who waits on your table and they've got one fingernail painted. It's all witchcraft. It's all demonic.
Yeah.
So those are the people who bit the last one. I will give you everything your hearts desire, but you need to sell your soul or make a commitment to me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's so blatant now that we have song people. This lady was in an interview, and they said, why do you keep, every time you do an interview, you got one eye covered up? She goes, because I sold my soul to the devil, man.
Wow.
And she's a super popular...
Pop star.
So, people are tempted to give up their morals...
Right, and their heart.
...to achieve something in the natural realm.
Mercy, worship. Right.
Businessmen.
Yep.
Who will cut corners.
Yep, Freemasons.
Not... corners like, do I want to take full advantage of the tax code? Absolutely, I don't want to give the government one penny. But guys start lying and cheating in what they do because they worship their money.
Right.
Yes.
That is a person who is selling their soul to the Babylonian
mm-hmm.
system.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
So after Jesus had overcome the three main temptations, angels came and ministered to him.
Hallelujah.
Now,
Hallelujah.
Why is that important to know? Because in Christ, I can do all things. So in Christ, Christ has already overcome all the temptations that are common to man.
That's right.
There, it just can't seem to stop, you know, looking at this or doing that. Oh, yeah, you can. In Christ, you can say no to that.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Are any of you warm in here?
Yeah. It's 71.
Or is it just me?
It's you.
It's the fire. I am up here and it's like the middle of summer in San Antonio. How Jesus operated.
Right.
How did he operate? Well, let's take a quick gander. Got a couple slides here. In John 5:19, therefore Jesus said to them, yes, indeed, I tell you that the Son cannot do anything on his own, but only what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father does, the Son does. Mm. So Jesus started off by saying, I don't do anything that I don't see my Father do.
Right.
Well, now how are we going to translate that? You saw that, huh?
Amen.
What a wise man.
Yes.
An anointed man. He's my son from another mother that I adopted one day. We just ran across him and we took him in.
Praise God. Amen.
Okay, so John 5:9 is Jesus saying, this is how I operate. Well, how do I now translate that to me? Because I'm not seeing the Father. So in Galatians 5:16, Paul writes it this way. I say, walk by the Spirit.
Yes.
Amen. And you will not carry out the desires of the flesh.
Jesus.
For the desire of the flesh is against the Spirit,
so
and the Spirit against the flesh.
So
for they are in opposition to one another.
Yep.
In order to keep you from doing whatever you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you are not under the law.
Woo-hoo!
So in that scripture, he says, look,
good.
Walk not by what you see,
mm-hmm.
or what you understand. I love all you guys, but sometimes I laugh when you guys hang up the phone and you leave. Well, you know, Pastor, I thought this and I thought this and I thought this and I thought that. And I'm going, yeah, okay, now tell me what God said. And then I just really thought this would be a good idea. And I'm going like, oh, dear Lord. That is just how I used to operate.
Yeah.
I always operated, but, you know, I consider myself a pretty smart guy. I would look at something and I'd say, well, we should do this. And it worked a lot of times. And then there were times I did things that blew up in my face and like, oh my gosh, I didn't know that was going to happen. Now,
Spirit,
I try to be led by the Spirit in everything. Right. I mean, we get so weird. It's like, where do you want to go eat? I don't know. What do you feel like? I don't know.
We'll just pick something. We ask God.
And then we ask God, and, you know, I think we're supposed to go over here. And for the whole time I've been married to Heather, I cannot tell you how many times we've fought, had intense words to figure out where we were going to go eat, and then when we got there, we ended up having the manager come over. I've had managers of restaurants sit at my table so many times it's embarrassing. Or waitresses, or waiters, you know, would you pray for my daughter? I mean, we go into a restaurant and all the waiters and waitresses come over and say hi to us. Why? Because over the course of the years, we've ministered to all of them.
Amen.
So we don't go anywhere unless the Spirit of God says, this sounds good. Heather will go, you know, I was thinking about this place. What do you think? No. And then I'll go, hey, you want to go here? And she goes, no. Now, in the beginning, it used to drive me nuts. I like Chinese food. This was way in the beginning of our marriage. I said, there's a big Chinese buffet over here. And she goes, I don't feel good about that. I said, it's just a restaurant. We walked in and she goes, And I never saw it. At that point in time, I just thought, I love her. She's cute, but she's cuckoo. But now, I so respect the anointing and the Spirit on her. If she says no, if she says, I think we're supposed to do this, I say, go do it.
Amen.
The other day, she says, you know, Lydia's going to the Apostle Catherine's thing in Miami. She looks at me and she goes, you think I should go? Yeah, go. Buy the ticket right now. 5 minutes later, she had a ticket. She was on the phone with Lydia. Lydia's screaming and hollering and jumping around the house. See, when you're led by the Spirit, I didn't get my wallet out and say, I don't know, Heather. I don't know if we can afford it. You don't know if we're going to.
And the tickets were an amazing price.
And the tickets were like disgustingly cheap. And so I get a notice on my phone every day. Good time to buy your tickets. The price has increased $20. And then it was $50. And this morning it was $119.
Whoa.
See, when I'm led by the Spirit, I just do it.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Heather called me up and said, I think I'm supposed to buy a new car. Okay. I'm going to go to the Ford dealership. Will you meet me there? Okay. I grabbed a handful of money that I had. We drove over there. She looked at the very first car and says, I think that used one there. It's 2 years old. I'm supposed to buy that one. Go ahead.
Woo!
Amen.
It was absolutely the fastest deal. This is what I did. I had the down payment, and I said, we're not adding anything to the contract. But what? No. 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 And I, half hour, we bought the car. We were out the door. See, when you're in tune with the Lord, now, did I want her to buy a new car for months and months and months and months? Yeah, because I kept fixing the Range Rover. How much for shocks? Oh! But she heard the Lord say, today.
Hallelujah.
And then she went and found the car she wanted.
Hallelujah.
What a way to walk by the Spirit.
Amen.
So, Paul is explaining to us how we can do what Jesus did in John 5.
Oh, amen.
Okay?
Amen.
You know, I wasn't going to sit down today, Mike. I was going to tough it out. But my left knee started getting shaky, and I didn't know. In Mark chapter 4, verses 35, 41, that day when evening had come, Jesus said to them, hey, let's cross to the other side of the lake. So they all jumped in the boat and they headed out. Verse 37. A fierce storm arose. Now, stop. Jesus said, let's cross the lake. and you get hit with a storm.
Right.
God, why are you doing this to me? I don't know. I can't wait to tell you what happened to me 2 weeks ago, but I got to wait a little bit longer. It is so crazy and so amazing. I just want to tell. A fierce storm broke out. The waves broke over the boat. Have you ever been in a sea boat and waves start crashing?
No, yeah. I don't want to.
It is not a good feeling. I was in Biloxi, Mississippi, and we're heading out to Channel Island, and water spouts are forming over the ocean, and the waves start coming in, and a wave goes right over the front of the boat, and I'm going, can we go back? So they're out there in a storm. It's bad. But where's Jesus?
Asleep.
He was up in the front of the boat asleep. Now, if you've been following Jesus for the last year, and this was about between 12 months and 18 months into the ministry, you had seen him heal people, cast out demons, feed people, you probably would have said, well, I guess he's got it because he's okay. But they woke him up and they said, look at the verbiage because it's really important. They said to him, Rabbi.
Teacher.
Good teacher. They didn't acknowledge him as Lord. They didn't say God. They didn't say Messiah. They didn't say the Anointed One. Does it matter to you that we're about to be killed? Is that like a drama queen?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, that's like a 2-year-old. It's like, okay, you're not going to die. It's a splinter. Jesus woke, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, be quiet and still. The wind subsided, and there was a dead calm.
Amen.
He said to them, why are you afraid? Have you no trust even now?
Even now.
So after a year of walking with Jesus, they still didn't trust him. So when you see something, well, I've been saved for 37 years. You can be a baby.
Right.
I know newborn Christians that have more faith than the old salty dogs.
Come on.
Well, I guess this is my cross to bear. Yeah, the roof broke in. Sewer backed up. Wife left me. Dog died. Jeep blew up. Mom and dad died. I lost my job. No retirement. Wow! What a man of faith! But look at what the apostles said after he did that. He said, why are you afraid? Have you no trust now? But they were terrified and asked each other, who can this be?
Right.
They had no relationship with Jesus. They had no identity. So we go all the way back to our first scripture where Paul says, in unity,
union. Right.
I can't have union with Jesus unless I know him.
Right.
Well, you know, I read about Jesus in the book. Do you know him?
Do you know him like
that? Has he ever talked to you? I put up a prophetic word in 2011 of what God was saying was coming. And I made the mistake of saying this is what's going to happen in the next year. So 30,000 views on that video.
Wow.
178 people coming on telling me I was a quack. I was a nut. Well, congratulations. You're the first man in history who's ever heard God speak. What? Every Christian has heard God. We haven't listened all the time.
Amen.
But he's speaking to us.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
So they had no idea at that time who Jesus was. And they were totally shocked and amazed.
Amen.
Luke 4, verses 38-39. Leaving the synagogue, he went to Simon's house. Simon's mother-in-law was suffering from a high fever, and they asked Jesus to do something for her. So Jesus, standing over her, rebuked the fever, and it left her. She immediately got up, put on her apron, and started serving the apostles.
Come on.
The word rebuke means to admonish or sharply charged. So
out.
I don't get into my emotions. Pastor Heather doesn't. But I will say out in the name of. I will say it in a way that I am not. Debbie, lean that way. Just a little bit, okay. Because there's two heads that are doing this. I'm getting seasick. Can I listen to them? So, I can say with authority, out!
That's right.
But if I start running around the room, hitting people with a Bible, or screaming and hollering, I've now got into my emotions.
Come on, Apostle.
Yeah.
So, I can say it sharply. Stop. Be quiet. Come out. Okay?
Yeah.
That's how Jesus operated.
Hallelujah.
So he rebuked the fever and it left. Didn't say she was healed. So what was the fever?
A demon.
It was a demon. In Luke 9:42, even as the boy was coming, the demon dashed into the ground and threw him into a fit. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. So what did he do to the unclean spirit?
Yeah.
Rebuked.
Hallelujah.
Be quiet. Stop. Come out.
Yes.
Mark 9:25. When Jesus saw the crowd was closing in on him, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, you deaf and dumb spirit. Now,
hallelujah,
we understand that in some cases, you are going to identify the category or type of demon that is not
right.
Yes.
Not a marine serpent or not a, you know, a python or whatever. Not that. But what its assignment is.
Make you deaf and dumb.
Okay.
Yep. Yep.
Said, you deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him. And then now
never.
Here's the last part. That was interesting.
I love that.
And never return.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that.
Glory.
Yeah.
Amen.
In Matthew 17. Jesus rebuked the demon and came out of the boy so that from that moment he was healed.
Thank you, Jesus.
Today is a quick message, but here, two more. In Proverbs 18:21, the power of our tongue is the power of life and death, and those who indulge it must eat its fruit. So if I am always speaking death and negativity and hopelessness and dread and fear, I am telling the devil, you can come in and beat the snot out of me in those areas.
Yep. All right.
Yeah, you're eating your own words.
No, I don't receive that report.
That's right.
So our words are so important. So well, a lot of times I see people come up and we ask them to renounce. And every once in a while we'll get somebody and they're like, the demon is stopping them from talking. Because there's power in your voice. I remember a young man, you know, I still know him. He was for sure thought he was going to hell. And I said, no, you're not. That's a lie of the enemy. I says, nobody who's unsaved can say Jesus is Lord. Say Jesus is Lord. This is a grown man. He's going. He couldn't talk. I'm looking at him, and in the spirit, I see a monkey grabbing his jaw. And so I rebuked the demon, told him to come off. He breathed a big sigh and said, Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
So the enemy keeps you from saying what you need to say.
Amen.
And you just sit in church.
Jesus.
You know what set the enemy off this morning? The praise and worship. Praise and worship stirred up the anointing. The monkeys got all butt hurt. Started squealing. You know, when they start making noise, that's because they're scared. Because they're realizing, whoa, wait, somebody in here knows what they're doing.
Right.
Oh my gosh, there's a lot of them in here that know what they're doing.
Hallelujah.
And they start making a lot of noise.
Yep.
I would like you to, like, take a day and just be really conscious of what you say.
Amen.
How many negative comments, how many hopeless comments. You know, I was driving, I came over to the church early, and the restaurant wasn't open, so I turned the lights on, turned the heater on, got my industrial size chapstick, and was heading back, and a lady came zooming up alongside of me like she wanted to cut in front of me at the next intersection, and the words came into my head, "That fat cow."
That's not your thought.
That wasn't me.
That wasn't your thought.
Right.
No.
Right.
But you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years ago, that fat cow just cut me off. I would have said it.
Oh.
I would have said it. And so how many times do we say what the enemy throws into our head? It's not us, but we say it.
Oh, Lord.
My poor wife used to correct me so much. Larry, you're negative. You're negative. I'm going, no, I'm just pointing out how stupid it is. This, the guy who designed this house, this $3 million house in Newport Beach, was an idiot. By the time we got to the second house, she goes, "I want to get back in the car." Why? Look, if we go to another house, I can tell you how stupid they are. She goes, "Larry, you're negative." No, I'm not. I'm pointing stuff out. I was clueless that every thought that came into my head, I just bleh, bleh, bleh. Yeah. And poor Heather was just getting vomited on all day. What are you saying? What do you say about yourself? What do you say about your situation? Are you agreeing with the enemy, or are you contradicting the enemy?
Speak life.
Last one. John 10:10. Look at the verbiage, because it's important. The thief comes only in order to steal, kill, and destroy. So if you're seeing death and destruction in your life,
right,
it seems like everything you try to do is just there, stolen from you. Who's doing that?
The thief.
That is the thief.
The devil.
That means somehow with actions, your words,
open doors,
yeah, generational strongholds, you have allowed the monkey to come in and mess with your life. Jesus said, "I come so that you are guaranteed to have the best life ever."
Hallelujah.
It says may. That means I gotta plug in, grab a hold of, agree with God, and start declaring it over my life.
Supernatural life. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm gonna tell you. I want to tell. Can I tell, Mom?
Holy Spirit. Temperance.
Well, yeah, I'll go by what you mean.
Patience. Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Not yet.
So, what are we agreeing with? What are we believing? What are we saying about our situation?
Amen.
God has given us... I like this one better.
Yes.
I need to operate exactly like he did.
Yes.
Amen.
He's my mentor.
Yes.
He's my example.
Yes.
The only thing, well, there's a couple things that are different about Jesus than me. Larry, that's heresy. No, there's only a couple, because I live inside of him.
That's right.
And I'm literally his body.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't have the anointing without measure.
Amen.
I have anointing, and it's growing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I can't die for your sins.
No.
Never.
It's already done.
It's already been done.
Amen.
But everything else I can do.
Hallelujah.
Or I have access to it at the level of anointing I have.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Now you guys need to get away from, "I'm just a poor little Christian." No. In Christ, I am a bad mamma jamma. And if the Lord tells me to do something, I'm going to do it.
Amen.
Don't get out of the boat without Jesus inviting you.
Amen. Come on now.
Yeah.
Come on now. That's good.
Only do what you are called
to
do.
Amen. Hallelujah.
We are going to give you an opportunity to sow. Now, giving to the church is so I can eat chicken dinners on Sunday. You guys know that, right? There's a lot of teachers that I like that I don't listen to anymore because the theology is a little off. But Jerry Savelle was one of my favorite growing up in the Word of Faith. And he was unsaved, but his wife was. And he would come home from work, and then he'd come home, and there the pastor of the church was sitting at the table eating his fried chicken. And he would get so mad. What's that man doing in my house eating my fried chicken? So that's always a joke. You are not giving to me or heaven.
Amen. Come on.
You are not giving for us to pay our bills.
Nope.
You are giving as a testimony of God being your source.
Come on.
That is it. Now, I do not see hardly ever individual giving. I have people who break down the offering. I get the lump and I spend it. Okay? But every once in a while, I get to see. And I see a lot of people going above and beyond.
Amen.
A lot of people that I see their gift and I am humbled.
Wow.
There's been many a time I've sat in my office and cried over an envelope. Amen. Or I've cried over PayPal coming in. Or I cry over, you know, somebody sending me a gift. This is your testimony to God.
Amen.
That I trust you. And I know that everything that I have comes from you.
Amen.
I give more on one Sunday than when Heather married me, I gave in a year.
Amen.
Why? Because I now have the revelation that these $2 are not going to do me any good in my wallet. They're going to do more when I sow them into the offering.
Ooh, yeah. Praise God.
So never do an offering because the pastor said, well, we need to pay the electric bill. Never, 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 never. The minute that comes out of the pastor's mouth, leave the church.
Come on.
Because he has no revelation of giving or trusting God.
Mm.
So when I sow, I'm saying, thank you, Jesus. You are my source. So at the end of the service, I'm going to have you guys come up and throw them in the basket, but I'm going to pray over you right now, and then I want to get into praying for the people. Father, I thank you that you have set up a system that I can live in this Babylon world. But I don't rely on Babylon to put resources in my hand. I rely on you.
Yes.
So today as we sow, we are saying thank you, Lord, for being our source. Lord, and I just speak a blessing over all those who are sowing seed today. I declare that those seeds are blessed, that they will multiply, that they will come back a 30, 60, 100 fold, and it'll be a testimony of your goodness and your grace to this body of Christ. If you're online watching and you want to sow, you can go to our website and sow into the ministry, which is for this church and Pakistan. So we thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, the church said,
amen.
Amen. I'm going to go through some things, and if you want to partake in that, you can make a verbal acknowledgement.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, I renounce pride. I renounce self-righteousness.
I renounce self-righteousness.
I renounce offenses.
I renounce offenses.
I renounce that I'm a victim.
I renounce that I'm a victim.
I renounce all generational curses that have come down through the family line.
I renounce all generational curses that have come down through the family line.
glory.
I renounce every spirit that clouds my mind and affects my thinking. I renounce all sickness that's coming against my body. I renounce all religious spirits. In the name of Jesus, I detach everybody online and in the congregation who has renounced things, and I command every one of those spirits at the count of three to come off and out of them in Jesus' name.
Yes.
One, two, three, out! In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay, does anybody have any individual prayer requests or anything they want to come up for individually? If we covered everything, you're good.
Always go back. Keep trying. Okay. Just for a little bit and then instrument out.
It's been working a little bit. That dumb spirit, I guess. Autism, all the sickness in my body. What other? I can't. There is.
I got it.
Okay. I want you to, diabetes.
I want you to renounce this. I renounce.
I renounce.
All autism.
Autism.
All generational curses affected my mind.
My mind.
I renounce diabetes.
Diabetes.
The autism doesn't want to leave.
Doesn't want
to. No, it doesn't. I don't think I can tell. It doesn't want it, but you just renounce it so it has no story.
Yes.
Okay. At the count of three, I detach you first from all the things that you renounced. And at the count of three, I command all those spirits to come out of you.
Oh, you have to come out.
You have no choice.
I want to destroy them.
That's all right. You can't.
I want to destroy his ministry. He'll look great for
you. No, be quiet. You have no authority here. Count of three. One, two, three, out! In the name of Jesus. Just let it come. Let it come. How can I pray for you, young man?
I deal with a lot of things that get into my mind, like thoughts that shouldn't be there, temptations, sexual things that come against me, come against my mind. My flesh goes crazy, and I try to make the flesh
just let it keep going.
It doesn't want to listen and obey, and my mind, it gets all weird, and I got a lot of spiritual stuff I'm dealing with.
Okay. I'm going to run down a line of things for you to renounce, okay?
Okay.
I renounce. All spiritual friends.
All spiritual friends.
That came to me when I was a child.
That came to me when I was a child.
I renounce all perversion.
I renounce all perversion.
All mental attacks.
All mental attacks.
All generational curses.
All generational curses.
All witchcraft that has been spoken over me.
All witchcraft that has been spoken over me.
I renounce abandonment.
I renounce abandonment.
Orphan spirit.
Orphan spirit.
And every lie that says there's something wrong with me.
And every lie that says there's something wrong with me.
Okay. In the name of Jesus, I detach my brother from all these things that he has renounced. And at the count of three, I'm commanding every one of those spirits tied to these things to come out of him at the count of three. One, two, three, out! In Jesus' name.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you both together?
You want to do it together or you want to do it separately?
It's okay.
We can do a 1-2 punch.
Thank you.
You felt it as soon as you came in the church, didn't you?
Yeah.
Okay. That is, we got to separate from you and the demonic that's attached to you. And it can come and attach to you when you were a little baby, when you were a little kid.
when things transpired, when things happened to you, when you were hurt, when you whatever that transpired. So it's not like you went out and did something bad and they came in.
That's how I
feel. Okay, so it's not you. There's nothing wrong with you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Okay, same thing for you. See all this? You know what that's about? You don't like yourself. Because there was an abandonment of some sort. Absent father, absent mother, absent parent. And there's this anger in your belly. What's wrong with me? And the Lord says, nothing's wrong with you. You didn't do anything wrong. Okay? So for the two of you, I want you to renounce all the pain that people did to me as a child.
I renounce all the pain that people did to me as a child.
I renounce orphan spirit.
I renounce orphan spirit.
I renounce orphan spirit. I renounce being alone.
I renounce being alone.
I renounce being alone.
I renounce being unworthy.
I renounce being unworthy.
I renounce being unworthy.
I renounce all generational curses.
I renounce all generational curses.
Mm-hmm. I renounce all generational curses.
I renounce anything that I've done involving witchcraft.
I renounce anything I've done involving witchcraft.
I renounce anything I've done involving witchcraft.
Now, I'm going to detach you from those things, and I'm going to command them to come off of you.
Anger comes
from the
immorality.
There's some, what's wrong with me? Why am I alone? Why did they leave me? So all that is tied in with the orphan spirit and the abandonment spirit, all that anger. But renounce anger.
Yeah.
Just renounce anger.
And anything else?
And all violence.
All violence, sexual immorality.
Okay. Any sexual perversion that's come into my life, I renounce sexual perversion.
I renounce sexual perversion.
I renounce sexual perversion.
This might be something that needs to be done a couple times. So we're going to do a lot today, but it might be come back, get some more, okay? But you're going to be really clear-headed today.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, I detach my sister and my brother from those things that they renounced. And at the count of three, I command every spirit tied to those things they renounced to come out of them at the count of three. One, two, three. Out.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Command all those spirits of anger and rejection to come out of them right now.
It's okay,
Joseph. Out. Come out of them right now.
Amen. Amen.
Now, just stay there and let God do what He's going to do with you. Just ignore the rest of the congregation. Close your eyes and just believe that God is coming in and pruning all the junk out of your life.
Hallelujah.
All the stuff that has come upon you.
Hallelujah.
That had nothing to do with you. It was some stuff that was done to you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, have her stay there. Okay, just... But sit down, I'm going to come back to you. I'm like concierge, I come to you. How can I pray for you? Wait a second. How do you feel?
I feel clear-handed.
You got some junk out of the trunk, didn't you?
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
cleared up a little clutter in the house.
Glory.
I wanted to say, since I first came into this church, that I could feel the Spirit, and as soon as worship starts, I feel like I need to cry.
It's okay.
And that's okay. Because if I can cry in front of y'all, you can cry in front of me. But what can I help you with right now, sister?
Well, I'm battling on top of my daughter. I'm a single mother. My daughter has ADHD and ODD, so she does everything I ask her to do. She has the spirit of lying and gluttonous overeating. And I need God in my house.
Okay. I'm gonna give you some changes right now that you can do as mommy. I will never say anything negative about my daughter again.
I will never say anything negative about my daughter again.
Because it's not your daughter that's the problem. It's the demonic that has attached themselves to her. Okay? Hi, honey. What's your name? Say it again.
Anila.
Anila. That's pretty fancy.
It's Hebrew from Gift from God.
Really?
Wow.
So when mommy, wait. So when mommy had you, she said you were a gift from God? Wow.
She's my fifth pregnancy, my only baby to make it.
Wow. Okay. Okay. So mom, we're going to renounce all the negative things that you said over your daughter. Just say, I renounce. Every lie.
Every lie
that I've spoken over my child.
That I've spoken over my child.
I do not judge my child.
I do not judge my child.
By the flesh.
By the flesh.
Amen.
Amen.
I want you to just say these things, okay? I renounce. Orphan spirit.
Orphan spirit.
Not good enough.
Not good enough.
Being alone.
Being alone.
Anger.
Anger.
Okay, that's a good start. In the name of Jesus, I detach both of you from the things that you just renounced, and I command every spirit that has attached itself to you through these things to come out and off of you at the count of three. One, two, three, out!
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. I speak clarity over their minds. I speak over their minds that they will only say what Jesus says over every situation. They will no longer speak what the enemy says. And they will allow God to come into their lives and free them from all the hurt and pains that the enemy has perpetrated upon you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
God says he likes you. Words that have been spoken over you guys is working. You might start coughing tonight, you might cough later, you might cough when you're in the car, but it's happening. Just let it happen. There's nothing wrong with you. You're getting free, okay?
Another thing I wanted to ask for prayer about, I would like to pray about renouncing any and all plans of the adversary that are keeping me from finding a woman to be in my life, okay. So I'm not alone.
I want you to say this. In Jesus' name,
I curse
all the plans of the enemy.
All the plans of the enemy.
And I declare
that I am free
from all his lies.
In Jesus' name.
Okay. Every single spirit that has come against my brother in those areas, I command them to come out at the count of three. One, two, three, out.
Hallelujah.
You know what just happened? Fire of God just came through my hand and hit that demon in your tummy. He just went, ah! And he's leaving. Amen. So you just let him go.
Amen.
Amen. I want to read that drug addiction.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Can I take your hat off? Look at me. You're a good looking guy. Okay? Calm yourself. Okay. Did you wake up one day and say, hey, you know what? I think I want to be a crackhead. I want to smoke the meth pipe.
No.
Okay, so this is the byproduct. Because you know why I know? Because I smoked the pipe for 10 years. And I probably haven't gone through a percentage of what you have. But you get pushed there because of the lies of the enemy. You know how long I had to go to rehab to get off the pipe? Zero. Okay? So renounce. I want you to renounce all addictions.
I renounce all addictions.
What's your drug of choice?
Meth.
Okay, I renounce meth.
Marijuana.
Marijuana. You renounce it. I renounce marijuana. And I renounce meth. In the name of Jesus, I detach my brother from those two drugs. I detach him from any addictive spirits that have come into his life.
That's right.
And at the count of three, I'm going to command all of them out. One, two, three, out.
Glory.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Did it start in praise and worship?
Amen.
So, is it going to dissipate?
No.
Listen closely. The anointing is going to continue to grow.
Hallelujah.
If you want to be a partaker, you need to embrace it. You need to let go of your old mindset, your old way of thinking, your old way of doing things. Don't come up to me and say, well, that's just the way I am.
No.
No, you're not. That's a lie from the enemy.
Amen.
I can be the perfect vessel for God if I surrender.
Amen.
So I want you to develop a surrendered mindset.
Amen. That's right.
Hi, Michael. How are you doing, brother? Good to see you. Your knee? Your leg? You can't do tap dancing anymore?
No reggae dance.
No reggae dancing?
No reggae song.
I am the Son of the Most High.
I'm a Son of the Most High.
Yes.
And no weapon formed against me shall prosper.
And no weapon formed against me shall prosper.
And I renounce all this pain and hurt in my leg.
I renounce all this pain and hurt in my leg.
Yes.
And I declare that I am healed.
And I declare that I am healed.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Right.
In the name of Jesus, I detach my brother from every spirit of inflammation and pain that's affecting his leg. And I command them to come out at the count of three. One, two, three, out! In Jesus' name. I release the fire of God into this leg, into this joint, into these muscles, into these tendons. And I declare that they are made new in Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah!
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
And homelessness.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory. Hallelujah.
Woo!
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. The woman I was, I worked hard all the time. I had everything. And when I got addicted to meth, everything.
Are you still struggling?
Yeah.
With meth?
Yeah.
I
renounce it. I renounce meth.
Any other drugs?
No, just meth.
Okay. I renounce hopelessness.
I renounce hopelessness.
Thank you.
I renounce every lie that says this is my fault.
I renounce every lie that says this is my fault.
Every spirit that keeps me from being who I am called to be.
Every spirit that keeps me from being who I'm called to be.
Okay.
Thank you, God.
Stand here. I'm going to use your hand. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
No, that's my part.
Oh.
In the name of Jesus, I detach my sister from all those things that she renounced.
Thank you.
And I command every one of those spirits to come out of her at the count of three. Every single one. One, two, three, out!
Glory.
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 Thank you, God.
Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Now,
Thank you, Jesus.
I'll use me. I'll talk about me. When I came to my senses over in San Bernardino, and I'd been smoking the crack pipe for about 10 years, there was a lot of stuff on me other than crack pipe.
Right.
So the crack pipe was a byproduct of the little boy who had been rejected, abandoned, who felt unloved, because mommy and daddy couldn't fill those voids. So this outer stuff that we're dealing with right now, we're going to dig down to where we're eventually going to deal with that I feel unloved. And that'll be the root. But we're going to clear some of the vegetation out of the way. And on the next or second or third time, we'll deal with I don't feel loved. Because, you know, all of us at certain times of our life have felt nobody loves me.
That's right.
Nobody cares about me. I don't even know if anybody knows I'm alive.
Thank you, Jesus.
Very good. So, what comes out of your mouth now?
Thank you, Jesus.
God loves me.
God loves me.
He's got a plan.
I'm free.
I'm not going to let the monkey run my life ever again.
I'm not going to let the monkey run my life ever
again. Amen. Amen.
You
Amen.
Do you live close around? Or
I'm homeless.
Okay. Are you homeless close around? Or
yeah.
Okay. I would do whatever I could to get here every Sunday.
She'll be with me.
Okay.
And praise God. She'll be with
me. Bring her on a Friday night. That'll rock her world.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wednesday.
So we've started.
Okay.
We've cut some of the big trees down and we're gonna get to some roots, okay? So don't hesitate to come back with your friend and continue to get this stuff tore out until you're free and you can be what God has called you to be. Amen?
Amen.
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 But no guilt or shame. Okay? God bless you.
Lord.
I have a major problem with my back. I've been having problems for years for me. Been a lot of car wrecks and stuff. So
do you need to go to a driving school or?
No.
Oh, okay.
It's been through a lot because it changes where I live. So.
Okay.
And this is my back and this is my whole body and stuff and high blood pressure and then make sure the cholesterol's down and all that, and then any spirit of death or anything like that trying to come on, mm-hmm. anything else trying to wipe things out, you know.
Okay, I renounce
sickness,
fear.
Yes, God. I'm afraid of. Well, I am afraid of a lot of stuff.
That's the enemy. Right? That's the enemy. I want you to renounce all fear.
All fear.
All fear of diseases. They're not mine.
They're not mine.
I don't receive them.
I don't receive them.
I renounce the pain in my back.
The pain in my back.
And I receive total restoration today.
Restoration today.
By faith.
By faith.
In Jesus' name. Okay. In Jesus' name, I detach my brother from the things that he just renounced. I command every one of those lying spirits to come out of him at the count of three. One, two, three, out. And I release the fire of God in his body to burn out all the works of the enemy, to restore his health, to make right everything that the enemy made wrong, and that he'll walk out of here today free and healthy and made
yes.
new,
yes.
and his mind will be clear in Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you, Jesus.
So today your assignment is I am not going to repeat any lie of the enemy. So every time you talk, hey, God's got me. I'm healthy.
Amen. Okay.
Yeah, I feel good. I think I'm going to go to the gym and throw some weights around.
Okay.
You're not gonna say the negative anymore. Okay. You're here.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
See, you were called here. Now you just the word's working, so you just sit down and let it work. God's just working on you right now, brother, okay?
Amen.
Strong, tall woman of God.
Amen.
How can I help you, sister?
I was just early this morning, and especially when I came here, so it's like really nauseous.
Hmm.
You trust me? Okay. So I'm going to throw some stuff out there that might sound different. Okay? Look at me. Got a pretty smile. I renounce all
ethnic
curses. I renounce every lie of the enemy.
I renounce every lie of the enemy.
I am free.
I am free.
I am a child of the Most High. And there is nothing wrong with me. He loves me. Beyond anything I can imagine. And the demons that are still attached to me are leaving now.
Amen.
The count of three, I'm going to command all those to come out of you, okay? Crying, coughing, okay? Or yawning, don't swallow your gum. In the name of Jesus, I detach my sister from all those things that she just renounced. And I command every spirit that has attached itself to her through those areas to leave her at the count of three. One, two, three, out. How's your tummy? That is literally a demonic entity like a snake running around in your soul. Okay? Now I spoke the word. It will happen. It's either going to happen right this second, it's going to happen when you sit down, it's going to happen when you drive home, but it is going to happen.
Amen.
And you just say, He spoke over me, I am free, I am free, I'm not under any of those curses anymore. Okay? In the name of Jesus, I release the fire of God to burn out of you every single thing the enemy has done in your life.
Amen.
All the residue to your body, your mind, and your soul. I release the fire now and say you are free. Free.
Woo! Glory! Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Anybody else?
Amen.
Yes, ma'am.
I've been having like a pinched nerve in my neck.
We don't do pinched nerves. No pinched nerves.
Yeah, and that's why I need to say it.
In Jesus' name, I command this neck and these nerves all to straighten out. There's no pinch. All the vertebrae and muscles and tendons to be free. And any spirit that's causing this to happen to her neck, I command it to come out of her right now. At the count of three. One, two, three, out. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
This neck is loose and free in Jesus' name.
Yes.
I just release the fire of God to burn out all the things the enemy has done in your neck, and that you are free.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Love you guys. Keep coming, keep receiving, keep growing, and expecting good things from your Father.
Amen. Yes.
If you're sowing, make sure to hit the basket before you leave. In the name of Jesus, I just release the favor and the grace of God over the audience watching, over those who are here in the house, that they are blessed in everything that they do. And that they are led by the Spirit and not by the flesh. And they embrace everything that Jesus has done for them. In Jesus' mighty name. And the church said,
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
God bless you guys and have a great week.
Hallelujah.